Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel Network Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. Wisdom is understanding God's Word. Pastor Murray's unique teaching approach brings God's Word alive with meaning as he takes you on a chapter-by-chapter, verse-by-verse study of God's letter to you, the Bible. And now, here is Pastor Dennis Murray.
Good day to you. God bless you. Welcome to Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this Family Bible Study Hour. Ready to get back into our Father's Word here at the chapel? We're going to pick it up today, 2 Kings chapter 5, verse 1. We invite you to get your Bible and join us if you care to. We're getting ready to have an old-fashioned Bible study here at the chapel. You recall when Elijah was taken up to heaven, just before that, he asked Elisha, before he threw his mantle on him, or actually Elisha bent over and picked up Elijah's mantle and put it on himself. But Elijah asked him, said, you know, what can I do for you? What kind of blessing can I give you? And Elisha said, I'd like a double portion of the Spirit that is upon you. And you know, Elijah performed 8 miracles. Elisha, the Spirit was doubled. He performed 16 miracles recorded in God's Word. And, you know, miracle after miracle, it looks like the people of Israel, who Elijah and Elisha were sent to, would get it. You know, time and time again, God has proven that He is the God of Israel. We're going to see in our lecture today, the people realized that there were miracles being performed, but they were giving credit to the man, the prophet, not to the God of heaven and earth, the God of Israel. With that introduction, let's ask that word of wisdom in Yeshua's precious name. Father, we ask you to open eyes, open ears this day as we pick it up. 2 Kings chapter 5, verse 1. Chapter 5 deals with Naaman, the captain or the general of the Syrian army, who had been struck with leprosy, and also Gehazi's punishment, the servant of Elisha. Chapter 5, verse 1, and it reads, "Now Naaman, captain, or probably better, general of the host of the king of Syria, was a great man with his master, and honorable, because by him the Lord had given deliverance unto Syria." Note, who was it that gave deliverance to Syria? L-O-R-D in all caps, 99% of the time is Yahweh in the manuscripts. And this deliverance probably from the Assyrians, which was a different nation. "He was also a mighty man in valor, but he was a leper." Now, in Israel at this time, a leper, no way would he have been allowed to continue in the army. A leper was actually exiled from any community. They had to live out away from other people. A leper was seen as someone who was unclean, in other words. Now, this king of Syria, by the way, probably Ben-Hadad II, in other words, the son of the first Ben-Hadad. Jesus quoted the scripture in Luke chapter 4, verse 27. In fact, a few verses before that, Jesus says, you know, there were many widows in Israel, but God chose a woman of Zidon to send Elijah to. And there were many lepers in Israel, but God chose Naaman to send to Elisha, the prophet. God will use whomsoever he will. Verse 2. "And the Syrians had gone out by companies." This kind of loses it in the translation. What this means is that the Syrians were going around in marauding bands, including into the land of Israel, the 10 tribes to the north, "and had brought away captive out of the land of Israel a little maid, and she waited on Naaman's wife." She was taken captive by one of these marauding bands of Syrian army, and taken back and sold, like, most likely into servitude to Naaman's wife, probably helped him with her with housework. Now, this is being stated to set up how it is that Naaman came to learn about Elisha, the prophet of Israel. And she said unto her mistress, the wife of Naaman, "Would God, my Lord," note the small case L, and this is referring to Naaman, "were with the prophet that is in Samaria," in Israel, Samaria being the capital of the 10 tribes at this time, "for he would recover him of his leprosy." And we see here that I mentioned as we began our lecture, did the maid give God credit for the miracle of cleansing Naaman? No, she said, if he was in the presence of the man, Elisha could cure him of his leprosy. Now, Elisha nor Elijah had an egotistical bone in their body. They were both very, very humble people. And I'm sure that it kind of irked Elijah and Elisha that the people were giving them credit for these miracles when they knew full well the power was that of the God of heaven and earth. She has faith in Elisha, not faith in God, as expressed in this verse, verse 4. "And one went in and told his lord," told Naaman's lord, who is Ben-Hadad II, the king of Syria, "saying, thus and thus said the maid that is of the land of Israel." They went in and reported to the king what the maid of Israel had said, that if Naaman would go to Elisha, Elisha could heal him of his leprosy. Verse 5, "And the king of Syria said, go. In other words, go to Samaria, the capital of the 10 tribes, and he's speaking, of course, to Naaman, his general. "And I will send a letter unto the king of Israel. And he departed and took with him 10 talents of silver and 6,000 pieces of gold and 10 changes of raiment." These were gifts intended to purchase, if you will, the cleansing of Naaman. Verse 6, "And he," being Naaman, "brought the letter from Ben-Hadad to the king of Israel." It doesn't state here, but it's likely Jehoram, the second son of Ahab, who became king over the 10 tribes, "saying, now when this letter is come unto thee, behold, I have therewith sent Naaman, my servant, to thee, that thou mayest recover him of his leprosy." Ben-Hadad is saying, okay, here he is, cure him of his leprosy. And you know, Ben-Hadad didn't mean anything negative about this letter. He was of a heathen nation. He felt like, Jehoram, you're the king of that land. Elisha is within your borders of your land. Have Elisha cure Naaman of his leprosy. It didn't mean anything by it, but Jehoram is going to take it negatively, as we'll see. Jehoram will take it wrong. Verse 7. "And it came to pass, when the king of Israel had read the letter, that he rent his clothes," as a sign of being fearful or frustrated, "and said, am I God to kill and to make alive, that this man doth send unto me to recover a man of his leprosy? Question. Wherefore consider, I pray you, and see how he seeketh a quarrel against me." Jehoram is accusing Naaman, and he knows Naaman is a general in the Syrian army, and he suspects that Naaman has come to spy out the land to see where they can attack and to destroy the 10 tribes to the north of Israel. Now, you have to understand, too, Leprosy in the Hebrew tongue is zarath. It's of the word, prime word zarah, which means to strike. You see, one with leprosy was one seen as stricken by our Heavenly Father. So you see where Jehoram's coming from here. God struck Naaman with leprosy, and he's sending him to me. Does he think I'm God that I can cure or have Naaman cured? Verse 8, no faith on the part of Jehoram either. Verse 8, and it was so when Elisha, the man of God, had heard that the king of Israel had rent his clothes, that he sent to the king saying, wherefore hast thou rent thy clothes? Well, what's the problem, Jehoram? Let him come now to me, referring to Naaman, and he shall know that there is a prophet in Israel. And again, Elisha didn't have an egotistical bone in his body. He's not saying this to build himself up, this last phrase, that he'll know that there is a prophet in Israel. What his intention is there of saying, he'll not only know that there's a true man of God in Israel as opposed to the 400 prophets of Baal and the 400 prophets of the groves that Ahab and Jezebel seem to always have around. What he's intending by this is that there is a God in Israel, and his name is Yahweh, not Baal. Verse 9. So Naaman came with his horses and with his chariot and stood at the door of the house of Elisha. Now realize he's gone to a lot of trouble to be where he is at this point. It was a long, hard journey, and of course they didn't hop on a jetliner and make a 2-hour flight. It was days probably, weeks possibly, that it took for Naaman to arrive at the house of Elisha. And no doubt he had a lot of servants. It was quite a train. He had to have servants to carry this 10 talents of silver and 6,000 pieces of gold and the 10 raiments of clothing along with him. So keep in mind, Naaman has gone to a lot of trouble to be where he is at this point. Verse 10, and Elisha sent a messenger unto him, saying, go and wash in Jordan 7 times, and thy flesh shall come again to thee, and thou shalt be clean. Just matter-of-factly, simple as that. Naaman, go down to the Jordan River, dip yourself in the Jordan 7 times, and you'll be cleansed. Well, we're going to see that Naaman is going to be a little bit angry at Elisha. Number one, he didn't even come and tell Naaman himself. He sent a messenger, and Naaman feels like he's been slighted by Elisha. He's going to be offended somewhat. Verse 11, but Naaman was wroth, he was angry, and went away and said, behold, I thought, or I said, better translated, he, referring to Elisha, will surely come out to me and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God and strike his hand, this is to move his hand up and down, over the place, over the affected area from the leprosy, and recover the leper. And we can learn from this, God doesn't like circus sideshows. Elisha just said matter-of-factly, go down to the Jordan, dip yourself in 7 times, and you'll be cleansed. He didn't have to go through a big rigmarole sideshow of look what I did, I cured him. Elisha knew it wasn't he who cured Naaman, it was God. Again, Naaman feels like he's been slighted. Verse 12, and this is Naaman's response. Are not Abana and Pharpar, rivers of Damascus, both rivers in Syria where he was from, his home land, Damascus being the capital of Syria at this time. Better than all the waters of Israel. May I not wash in them and be clean? Question. So he turned and went away in a rage. I could have washed seven times in the rivers at home and saved myself a lot of trouble and a long journey. And Elisha doesn't even have the decency to come out and talk to me himself, is what Naaman's thinking. And his, Naaman's servants, came near and spake unto him and said, My father, this is a title of honor and affection. It means counselor, or you could even translate it master. If the prophet, Elisha, had bid thee to do some great thing, some difficult thing, wouldest thou not have done it? If it would have cleared your skin of the leprosy? Of course, the answer is yes, you would have done it. How much rather then, when he saith to thee, wash and be clean? You know, we've tried everything else, boss, and you know, if the prophet Elisha had told you to go climb a mountain 10 times, and you would be cleansed, you probably would have done it. He didn't ask any great difficult or instruct you to do any great difficult thing. He said, just go down to the Jordan, dip yourself in seven times, and you'll be cleansed. Isn't that worth at least a try? Then went he down and dipped himself seven times in Jordan, according to the saying of the man of God. And his flesh came again like unto the flesh of a little child, and he was clean. Not only did he get his normal complexion back, his skin was perfect as that of a little child. This should and will have a tremendous impact on Naaman, the general of the armies of Syria. We're going to see a conversion of sorts on his part. Verse 15, and he, this being Naaman, returned to the man of God. This would be some 30 miles. He and all his company, and came and stood before him, and he said, Behold now, I know that there is no God in all the earth but in Israel. Now therefore, I pray thee, take a blessing of thy servant, referring to himself. And here he's professing that there is no other God except Yahweh, the God of Israel. And he's encouraging Elisha to take a gift, a present. Remember, he brought 10 talents of silver, 6,000 pieces of gold, and 10 changes of raiment. The value of that silver and gold today would be astronomical. Verse 16, but he, this being Elisha, said, As the Lord liveth, and this is an oath, before whom I stand or I serve, I will receive none. And he urged him to take it, but he refused. And here Elisha, we see, avoiding any chance of being perceived as being selfish. And you know, that's a indication that a prophet is false. You see, false prophets are in it for the money. They don't want you to think that God said this or God did that. A false prophet wants you to think that they, the man, did that or said this. So again, Elisha avoiding any indication of being a false prophet or being selfish. Jesus spoke on this matter in Matthew chapter 10, verse 8, when he says to his disciples, Go forth and heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out devils. Freely you have received, freely give. Elisha had been given the gift of a prophet and the ability to perform miracles as a gift. He gave freely. Verse 17, And Naaman said, shall there not then, I pray thee, be given to thy servant, to me, Naaman speaking, two mules burden of earth? For thy servant, again referring to himself, Naaman, will henceforth offer neither burnt offering nor sacrifice unto other gods, small g, but unto the Lord, but unto Yahweh. And this kind of loses it, difficult to understand. You see, the heathen nations believed at this time that a god was the god of a particular nation. So what Naaman's asking is, let me load up two large bags of soil from Israel, so when I return home to Syria, I can stand on the soil of Israel only when I make sacrifice to the God of Israel. Verse 18, in this thing the Lord pardon thy servant, again Naaman speaking, that when my master, that's the king of Syria, Ben-Hadad II, goeth into the house of Rimmon, which was the principal deity of the Syrians, he was known as the storm god, to worship there, and he leaneth on my hand. In other words, I'm in his service as his general, and I bow myself in the house of Rimmon. When I bow down myself in the house of Rimmon, the Lord pardon thy servant in this thing. And this is kind of difficult to keep up with, but what Naaman is saying is, you know, politically, I'm going to have to go in to the house of Rimmon in my daily duties serving the king of Syria, Ben-Hadad. And if I go in and have to follow through with him and bow down to Rimmon, will Yahweh forgive me, pardon me? That's what he's asking Elisha. Elisha isn't going to answer. Verse 19, and he said unto him, go in peace. So he departed from him a little way. And Elisha realizes that it's up to Naaman to decide who it is he's going to worship. I think Elisha, too, is making a point and giving us some instruction that, you know, it's not where you worship, it's who you worship. And that's very important for us today. You know, under the law, in the time when the temple, the Ark of the Covenant, was in the temple, man had to go to Jerusalem to worship the Lord. Now it does not matter where you are, it's who you worship. Verse 20, but Gehazi, the servant of Elisha, the man of God, said, behold, my master hath spared Naaman, the Syrian, in not receiving at his hands that which he brought, all those gifts that he brought. No doubt Gehazi had been eyeballing the 10 talents of silver, the 6,000 pieces of gold, and the 10 changes of raiment. But as the Lord liveth, here he's taking an oath, I will run after him and take some what of him. Now let me ask you, where is Gehazi's heart? Gehazi's heart is concerned about the wealth, the 10 talents of silver, the 6,000 pieces of gold, the 10 changes of raiment. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 6, 24, you can't serve God and mammon. Gehazi is serving the mammon in his heart at this point in time. He's thinking, boy, it would, you know, they came all that way from Syria to Israel and brought all those gifts. It would sure be a shame for them to have to take all those gifts all the way back to Syria. No one will know if I try and get some of it for myself. 21. So Gehazi followed after Naaman. And when Naaman saw him running after him, he lighted down from the chariot to meet him, and said, "Is all well?" This word "well" is shalom in the Hebrew, peace. Is everything okay? Naaman certainly would have recognized Gehazi as Elisha's servant. And when he saw him coming and coming hard, he thought, well, maybe something's wrong with Elisha. Is everything okay? 22. And he, this is Gehazi, said, "All is well. My master," Elisha in other words, "hath sent me," that's a lie, "saying, behold, even now there be come to me from Mount Ephraim two young men of the sons of the prophets," two of the poor students of the sons of the prophets, the students. "Give them, I pray thee, a talent of silver and two changes of garments." He's lying like a dog. I mean, and what a crud. You talk about a con man. This is a con man in action. Verse 23. "And Naaman said, be content, knock yourself out. Take two talents." He just asked for one talent. He said, "Take two talents." And he urged him and bound two talents of silver in two bags and two changes of garments and laid them upon two of his servants, and they bare them before him. What a liar and a hypocrite is Gehazi. And here, you know, Naaman's being very generous. He's giving him more than what he asked for. And he's even saying here, "I'll have my servants carry it back home for you." 24. "And when he came to the tower, he took them," the two talents of silver, "from their hand and bestowed them in the house," in a hiding place, no doubt. "And he let the men go, and they departed." Well, Gehazi is feeling very fortunate at this point in time, I'm sure. Here he's gotten a load of silver and some fancy clothes, and nobody knows about it except Naaman, and he was able to get it back into Elisha's house in a safe hiding place. No one knows about it except Gehazi and Naaman, right? Wrong. 25. "But he went in and stood before his master. And Elisha said unto him, whence comest thou, Gehazi? And he said, thy servant went nowhither," didn't go anyplace special, liar. "And he said unto him, went not mine heart with thee?" My heart went with you, Gehazi, in spirit. "When the man," referring to Naaman, "turned again from his chariot to meet thee, is it a time to receive money and to receive garments and olive yards and vineyards? And what about sheep and oxen and men servants and maid servants?" Elisha's saying, exactly what is your price, Gehazi? What you are has already been determined. What your price is the only thing that's up for dispute. You see, Elisha knew exactly what Gehazi had done. And you know, had Elisha taken the money himself, he would have put it back into the school of the prophets. And we're going to see in the next chapter that the school of the prophets could have used the funds. So in other words, Elisha would have put the money to work doing God's work. So in effect, what Gehazi did was he conned Naaman into giving him God's money. And you know, that's one person, one entity that you cannot con, is your heavenly Father. You know, he hid the silver and the robes, the garments from Elisha, but you can't hide from our heavenly Father. So don't ever think that you can con God. But he was padding his own wallet with God's money. Very, very dangerous thing to do. The punishment and judgment in the next verse. "The leprosy therefore of Naaman shall cleave unto thee, and unto thy seed forever. And he went out from his presence a leper as white as snow, just as Naaman was one stricken by our Lord. Gehazi is also now stricken, Zarah in the Hebrew tongue, with Zarah, which is leprosy. A suitable punishment for the crime. Don't try and rob God. Don't try and con God. You can't get away with it. Chapter 6, let's go with it. We're not going to get very far, but let's go with a couple of verses here. We're going to see another miracle by Elisha, the miracle of the iron axe head. Chapter 6, verse 1. And the sons of the prophets, or students of the prophets, said unto Elisha, Behold now, the place where we dwell with thee is too straight for us. It's too narrow or too small. And it doesn't say which location. There were three schools of the prophets, one at Gilgal, one at Bethel, and one at Jericho. This one likely at Jericho because it was the closer of the three to Jordan, which is where they are going to end up going. Verse 2, Let us go, we pray thee, unto Jordan, and take thence every man a beam, and let us make us a place there where we may dwell. And he answered, Go ye. You go ahead and build a new building, a new home for the school. And one said, one of the sons of the prophets, Be content, I pray thee, and go with thy servants. And he answered, I will go. So they're going to relocate one of the schools of the prophets. Verse 4, So he went with them, and when they came to Jordan, they cut down wood, making logs for which they could build the new school. But as one was felling a beam, cutting a tree down, the axe head, in the Hebrew this is iron, fell into the water. And he cried and said, Alas, master, for it was borrowed. Actually, it was begged. They couldn't even afford to buy an axe. So that's why we see so much sorrow at this loss, that it was they couldn't afford to replace it. And the man of God said, Where fell it? Show me where it went into the water. And he showed him the place. And he cut down a stick and cast it in thither. And the iron did swim. The iron axe head floated to the top. Verse 7, Therefore said he, Take it up to thee. And he put it out his hand and took it. The point, God can relieve all of our needs. All these miracles that God sent through his prophets to the people of Israel, it looks like they would have gotten it finally. The purpose of the miracles of God, one, was to show the people of Israel that there was a God of Israel, and his name was Yahweh. It was also to raise the conscience of the people of Israel toward the Lord. Will it work? Well, these miracles that Elisha are pretty powerful. It looks like they would finally get through to at least some of the people of Israel. We got a short message. We'll ask you to listen a moment, won't you please?
Genesis 1:46, the first six chapters in God's Word. The world that was. Did you realize there was a world age before this one? Same old world, different age. The creation itself. When were the races created? You see, all the races were created separately, and you'll find that documented in these particular CDs. How and what was the sin in the garden? It will be discussed in this series also. This is a must for the serious Bible scholar. For if you do not understand how it was in the beginning, you certainly will never understand the end. I think you will find this series very rewarding and certainly will answer questions that no doubt you have always wondered about. Genesis 1:46. Hey, I know you're going to enjoy this series.
Welcome back. We're glad you could join back with us. Let's have the 800 number, please. 800-643-4645. That number good throughout Puerto Rico, the U.S., and Canada. If you have a biblical question that you'd like to pose to be answered on the air, feel free to call that 800 number and leave your question. Please don't ask questions about a specific individual, denomination, or organization by name. We try to teach God's word in a positive manner, throwing out negative about others by name, especially our brothers and sisters in Christ, serves no purpose. We simply won't do it. We'll allow God's word to do the teaching, the correcting, and the healing. If you're studying via the internet somewhere around the world that's unable to use that 800 number, your announcer at the end of the hour will give you our mailing address. Quite all right to mail your questions in being the point. Got a prayer request? Well, we can do away with the telephone number. You won't need a mailing address. Your Heavenly Father is there for you 24/7. I encourage you to talk with your Father. You should be able to talk with him just like he's your flesh father. He's the closest relative that you have. Let him know that you love him. Don't ignore him. You know, that's a lot of his children today do ignore him. They completely forget about him. The only time it seems like he hears from them is when there's trouble. I need this. I need that. I'm hungry. Don't let that be the case with you. You know, just tell him that you love him and thank him for the many blessings that he bestows. And if you don't think he's bestowing blessings on you, I have a feeling you're taking them for granted. Let's go to him in prayer. Father, we come to you united as one in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. We ask you to look upon these, Father. You know their needs, addictions, alcoholism, drug addiction, Father. You know, if it is your will, a special blessing on each of these, Father. We ask you to look after our military troops who are in harm's way around the world, Father, as well. Watch over, guide, direct, touch, heal in Jesus' precious name. Amen and thank you, Father. All right, let's get to some questions. First up today, we have Sanchez in New Mexico. If a believer and an unbeliever get married together, are they supposed to become one? Does the unbeliever automatically go to heaven because they have become one? No, it doesn't work that way. 1 Corinthians chapter 7 covers unions that where one is a believer and one is a non-believer. And that is where you'll find how God looks upon relationships where one is a believer and one is not. I know what you're talking about. They become one. They become one flesh. And how is that? Well, they two become, when they have children, their two have become one flesh is what that means. Will Matta, I believe it is, in Illinois. If God gave Moses the Ten Commandments, and it said, thou shalt not kill, why did God tell his people to go into all the various countries and kill so many people? This has always bothered me. Well, you're confusing killing with murder, premeditated murder. The Ten Commandments in the original language, Jesus quoted in Matthew chapter 5, verse 21. It says, you've read that thou shalt not kill. And the Greek word is phanuo in the Greek language, and it means homicide, premeditated homicide. There's a lot of difference between that and killing someone in war. And God instructed Deuteronomy chapter 7, for example, God instructed the nation of Israel to completely wipe out the Canaanites. Why? Well, he states there in Deuteronomy chapter 7, if you don't, then you're going to take their daughters for your sons to wife. You're going to give your daughters to their sons to wife. And before you know it, you're going to be worshiping their gods, small g. God knew what he was talking about. It came to pass. Why? Because they didn't follow his instructions, which was to annihilate and completely wipe out the Canaanites. The Canaanites, by the way, had mixed with the Nephilim. The Perizzites in particular were notorious for mixing with the fallen angels. So what you had was descendants of the Canaanites and the fallen angels running around everywhere. There were giants in the land, and that's where they came from, was the offspring of the Nephilim, the fallen angels. Sid in North Carolina, thanks for your teaching of the Bible. You're welcome. Jesus will be back on earth for 1,000 years, but will Satan be back loose for a short while to try and get a few strays again? He's going to want as many to go into the lake of fire with him as possible. And yes, it's written, Revelation chapter 20, verse 4, that Satan will be loosed from that abyss where he'll be held for most of the 1,000 years, but at the very end of the millennium, he's going to be loosed for a short season. But he will not have his power base that he'll have before the seventh trump sounds, which is when Jesus returns, because the beast and the false prophet, that's the one world political beast, and the Antichrist will go into the lake of fire in Revelation chapter 19, verse 20, which is prior to the time that he will have a short period of time. Phoebe in California, will you tell me what you know about Phoebe? Romans chapter 16, verse 1. Phoebe, and if you translate it rather than transliterate it, means radiant. She was a servant of the church. In fact, she was the one who delivered Paul's letter to the Romans. You follow with the second question, will you compare Genesis 22:1 with James 1:13? Genesis says that God tempted Abraham, and James says that neither God tempteth he any man. Well, you're not reading James chapter 1 verse 13 quite accurately. What it states in James 1:13 is that God does not use evil to tempt any man. But you see, God will tempt man. He wants, you know, he's not going to go into war, and there is a spiritual war going on. God's not going to go into a spiritual war with untested weapons. And he will test your okra every once in a while to see what you're made of. You see, he doesn't want servants that are a bunch of hothouse lilies that are going to wilt at the first sign of trouble. He wants can-do servants that can get her done. And he will tempt test. He'll prove his weapons. You elect are his weapon. Jerry in Colorado, I am 51 and disabled, and I love the Lord with all I have. I live in a government housing place and have a hateful neighbor. He gets in my face and tells me he studied karate for 10 years. I said, is that supposed to scare me? I hate fighting, and I refuse, though, to tippy-toe around him, but I don't scare. I hate this tension. I have made a lot of change and afraid I will one time throttle him. I don't want this. Am I being tested, and how am I to handle this to be good in the eyes of the Lord? And I have your Bible and a lot of your CDs. Thank you all so much, and you're welcome. You know, if you know what I would do, Jerry, I'd recommend first of all that you anoint your building. And how do you do that? Well, you obtain some, use your anointing oil if you have it. If you don't, obtain some olive oil. You can do that at the grocery store, 100% virgin olive oil. And then ask your pharmacist if you can purchase an empty little bottle, a vial, from him. Most pharmacies will be glad to help you with that. And then you put a little bit of the oil in the vial, and in prayer you ask God to bless that oil and you promise God that you'll use it only for anointing purposes in obedience to Him. And you don't have to make a public display of it. You don't even have to say it out loud. You take the small amount of oil as you go by the entry to your building, and you anoint the doorpost, and you order all negative and evil, and any that piggybacks in on those coming and going from your building, out in the name of Jesus Christ. And you know, Jerry, if this guy that's threatening you is an actual black belt in karate, he knows full well that he would be held to a higher account if he assaults someone. You see, black belts in karate live by a different set of standards than regular citizens. I'm going to doubt that he is a black belt. You didn't say that he said he was. But again, if he truly were a student of karate, he would know that you don't go around assaulting and threatening people. There's no need for you to threaten people. You know what you've got and what you can do with it. Frank from California, a question about the elect before the synagogue of Satan. They are to remain silent, but can they mentally ask for God? Would silently asking for God to intervene be forbidden? Thank you so much for your reply and your ministry, and you're welcome. And there's nothing wrong at any point in time with praying to your Heavenly Father. Pray for His strength. You can lean on His strength at that time. You know, that's what Paul often said was, you know, when I'm weak, then I am strong. And what did Paul mean by that? That means when he's done all he can do, he turns it over to God. And then he has true strength. Why? Because he's tapping into the strength of God. Trust in your Father. Have confidence in Him. But wait for the Holy Spirit to speak through you. Carol in Pennsylvania, it really bothers me that I cannot give 10%, but I do give a love offering when I can. Please give this note to Pastor Dennis Murray. I really want to know the answer and if he thinks God forgives me. Well, you know, there's nothing for God to forgive you about. You know, God's very intelligent. He understands your financial situation, Carol. And, you know, Christians pay their bills, and if possible, they pay those bills on time. So what I would encourage you to do, Carol, is pay the rent, if you pay rent or the house payment, buy your groceries, buy your medicines, your prescriptions. Then, if you have anything left over, then if you want to make a small offering, God will respect that. But what we should do as Christians too is to work to get out of debt. You know, usury will, you know, God can fill your bucket with riches, but, and sometimes we do things ourselves that put holes in our buckets. One of the things we do to put holes in our bucket is get involved with too much usury. You see, you end up paying someone else 10 times what a refrigerator would have cost because you're making payments on it and paying usury. So use your head, get out of debt as quickly as you can, double up on those payments and become financially independent. Pray for God to help you to do that if you can't do it on your own. Deborah in Arkansas, as always, I thank our Lord for you and the people at the chapel. Well, thank you for that. My question, does a Kenite know that they're a Kenite, and does the Lord's elect, do the Lord's elect know that they are Kenites also? Most Kenites probably don't know that they're descendants of Cain. Some do. Some are children of Satan rather than children of God. And your final part of the question is interesting, very interesting. You see, God's elect are able to discern the presence of a Kenite. And don't ask me how to explain how that is, but I can tell you that if a Kenite enters a room, I can tell instantly. You can feel it. JD in South Carolina. In the book of Mark, it says that you can pick up a serpent and drink any deadly thing and it won't kill you. Please explain this. And JD is referring to Mark chapter 16, verse 18. And the word there is speaking metaphorically. Jesus gave us the power to tread on serpents, even Satan, in Luke chapter 10, verse 19. As far as drinking any deadly thing, it means that your reputation is such that it can stand up to untruths and gossip that wicked people will say about you. It does not mean that you can pick up a rattlesnake and that the snake won't bite you. You see, the serpent in God's word is also Satan. And again, Jesus gave us power to tread on serpents, the Satan in Luke chapter 10, verse 19. Speaking metaphorically there in Mark chapter 16. Janet in North Carolina, for the last 2 years, am I wrong for trusting God that I will not stay on dialysis for too much longer? Am I crazy to believe that God can take me off of dialysis in a couple of months? No, you're not crazy. If God wants to heal you where dialysis is not necessary in your life, Father certainly has the power to heal you. But while you trust and have confidence in God, you also need to trust and have confidence in your physicians. If you don't have trust and confidence in your physicians, if I were you, I'd change physicians, get another doctor. Your doctors will tell you whether you need dialysis or not. They run tests and they know whether if you get off of dialysis and you need it, you could end up dead. France in New Jersey. I think it's France, yeah, in New Jersey. What scripture can I use for anxiety? Please give me scripture. Thank you. Well, in Matthew chapter 6, verse 24, through in the following verses, Jesus is talking to his disciples there, you know, and he says, you know, why are you worried about what you're going to eat? Consider the birds of the field. God feeds his birds. How much more are you important to him than them? God takes care of his creation. He will take care of you as well. One of the best scriptures for handling anxiety, I think, is 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, which states that there's nothing that's going to happen to you that's not common to man. That means that it's not happened to someone else. And God is not going to allow you to be tempted above what you're able to handle. Jerry in New Mexico. God bless you and your staff. Thanks for remembering our staff. We have an extremely hard working group of volunteers and employees here. They get a lot of work done in a very short period of time. I have learned more watching your program every morning than any church I have attended. So I have been asking random church leaders if they believe in rapture theory, and they all do. So do you think it's okay that I haven't found a church to regularly attend? I love God and I have disappointed him enough in my life, but until God helps me find a church to attend, I consider Shepherd's Chapel my home church. Keep up the good work. And well, thank you for that, Jerry. And you know, when you study with Shepherd's Chapel, you are in church. And you're going to get a lot more of God's word taught, unfortunately, than what you're going to have taught in many churches across the country. Most churches are so busy teaching the traditions of men that they never quite get around to teaching God's word. Very unfortunate. Jerry in Colorado, the verse Joshua 24:2 is the speaking of the first world age. And Joshua says in 24:2, "Thus saith the Lord, your fathers dwelt on the other side of the flood." And you state, you and your staff have been a blessing in my life. Thank you, and thank you for that. Joshua 24:2, the word flood is nahar in the Hebrew language. And it means a stream, and especially the Nile or Euphrates River. And it's also, the word nahar is also translated in the King James Version Bible as river. Joshua 24:2, the flood is not talking about the flood that separated the first earth age and the second earth age. It's talking about the Euphrates River. Carolyn in Oregon, are the people of the right side of the Gulf in the third heaven age? They're in a spiritual body and have an eternal existence, not necessarily. Or is it after the seventh trump when the King of Kings, Lord of Lords appears? No, the third heaven age actually begins when God's throne descends to earth. Revelation 21, John said, "I saw a new heaven and a new earth." The seventh trump signals the beginning of the Lord's day, which is 1,000 years, the millennium. I'm out of time once again. I want you to know that I love you a great deal. Why? Because you enjoy studying God's word in depth. You know what? It makes God's day when he looks down and he sees you and you have the letter that he wrote to you open and you're studying his word, the Bible. It makes his day. We are brought to you by your tithes and offerings. If we've helped you, help us keep coming to you and to reach out to others who are lost in this world of darkness. One thing most important, though, it's this. You stay in his word every day, and your Father's word is a good day, even with trouble. Do you know why? It's because Jesus is the living word.
Hearing God's word with understanding will change your life. We hope you have enjoyed studying God's Word here on the Shepherd's Chapel Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. If you would like to receive more information concerning Shepherd's Chapel, you may request our free introductory offer. Our introductory offer contains the Mark of the Beast CD, our monthly newsletter with a written Bible study, a CD catalog, and a list of written reference works available through Shepherd's Chapel. To request our free introductory offer by telephone, call 800-643-4645, 24 hours a day. You may also request our introductory offer by writing to Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. Once again, that's Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. We invite you to join us for the next in-depth Bible study each weekday at the same time. Thank you for watching today's program, and God bless you.
Mark. Mark, one of the apostles, Mark having been a very young lad at the time Christ walked this earth, was always in the shadows observing and listening with the intensity that young ears can, picking up every word. And this great gospel moves very fast. But what a interesting and certainly impressive gospel it is for Mark, from those that young mind, reiterates to you in chapter 13 how some are going to be delivered up, exactly what they were supposed to do, and even in that 13th chapter giving you the seven events that fulfill this or make up the seven seals and the seven trumpets, and telling you how you are to react to them. A fast-moving gospel, one that I know you'll enjoy.
Thank you. Arkansas, this is Shepherd's Chapel with Pastor Arnold Murray. Join with us now as Pastor Murray takes you on a book-by-book, chapter-by-chapter, line-by-line study of God's Word. Now, here is Pastor Murray.
Right. Good day to you. God bless you. Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this Family Bible Study Hour. Praise God. What a independent study we're doing here on Satan's downfall. Isn't it wonderful that he has fallen? He's as good as dead, though he isn't dead. No one has